Hello and welcome or welcome back to International Yankee English. We post weekly videos on English learning topics. We have an entire community. Check out the description box to find out more ways that you can learn English with us and how to join our community. Today, you are going to learn the top 10 tips for how to learn English in 2021. Let's go. Okay, so tip number one is to immerse yourself. Anything and everything English, bring it to your life. Examples, anything you consume, you can most likely find in English. So let's say you read or watch a lot of news every day, whether it's cable news, television, or websites, blogs, podcasts, etc., maybe in good old newspaper. Consume that in English. There are many free options available or paid options. If you read or consume a lot of news on a daily basis, I highly recommend doing so in English. Other ways, perhaps you listen to a podcast on your way to work. Find a good English podcast. It doesn't have to be an English learning podcast. That may be a bit boring and demotivating for you. But find a topic. Let's say you like to hear about history or true crime stories. Find a podcast then in English that you can listen to for entertainment on your way to and from work. Other examples, let's say YouTube. Find your favorite YouTube channels across any topics. Of course, you should subscribe to some English learning channels such as this one. Hit the subscribe button and turn the bell on in order to get notifications about new videos. So several different favorite English learning channels are important to subscribe to and to watch and follow regularly, but also find some in areas that you find interesting. So whatever your hobbies are, maybe it's knitting, maybe it's cooking, maybe you like celebrity gossip, whatever it is. There are so many great channels on YouTube that are in English that you can subscribe to and you can watch and you can put a comment on and have comment conversations with the other viewers. Make sure all of this is done in English. Everybody needs to cook food, right? Are you trying a new recipe? Look up that recipe in English and do it that way. Find ways that you can bring English to your life and just immerse yourself in it as much as possible. Set your phone to English. Another thing that you can do that isn't based in technology is that you can simply find things in your home that you don't know the English word for. Grab a post-it note, write the English word for it, stick it on the item, and there, boom, you can learn more English words simply by being at home. Tip number two, I would like for you to set three SMART goals for your English learning this year. Goals are important because without a goal, you're kind of just wandering and picking at different things and maybe trying to watch an English video here or there, but you don't really have a set goal, an end goal, a place that you are going to end up. How are you going to improve your English? Why? In what way? When? How much? Which parts? That's all very important for you to know and understand. So I always advise more than one goal. You should have three goals for the year or for whichever time span you want to set for yourself, and they should be SMART goals. SMART is an acronym that stands for specific, measurable, achievable or attainable, relevant, and time-based. So let me give you an example of three poorly shaped goals. Let's say I want to improve my pronunciation, expand my vocabulary, and become more fluent. These goals are not very specific. They are difficult or impossible to measure. They're not really achievable since you can't measure them. You don't really know exactly what it is you're measuring and what you're trying to do. And we don't know if it's realistic for you to actually do it. And we have no idea when are you supposed to check if you have achieved these goals if you haven't set a time limit for the goal, right? So let's take the first one. I want to improve my pronunciation and let's make that a SMART goal. I would like to bring my speaking level from B1 now at the beginning of the year in January 2021, I would like to increase it and bring it up to level B2 on the Common European Framework. And I want to accomplish this by July 1st. So the basic goal, bring my pronunciation speaking level from B1 to B2 by July 2021. This is good because it's specific. You are focusing on one skill, speaking, okay? You can even specify it more to your pronunciation. So speaking is pretty specific enough. Pronunciation is part of that, but also simply the way that you communicate and link words together is a bit broader. You could just focus on pronunciation if you would like, but you know, it's up to you what your goal is. I would say speaking is already specific enough. And then it's measurable because you can test from B1 to B2. And I would say it is achievable or attainable because you have a 6-month time frame. If you put enough time and effort and energy into it, you can absolutely increase your speaking level from B1 to B2 in a 6-month time frame. Therefore, it is also realistic, right? And then it is time-based. You know exactly when you want to get it done by, so it hits all of those goals and boom, you have something that is actually going to happen. You're actually going to do it. So make sure that you set 3 SMART goals for your English learning progress this year in 2021. Tip number 3 is to test your level. It is almost impossible to set a SMART goal without actually knowing your starting point, your starting level. Now, mind you that this can change over time. Yes, maybe you passed a C1 Cambridge proficiency exam 3 years ago, but if you have not been consistently learning and using your English language skills in the meantime, you probably are not currently at the C1 level. Or maybe you have been watching or reading a lot of English, but you have not written a whole lot, for example, of business emails, or you haven't had a lot of conversations in English with people. So maybe your listening and reading skills have stayed at the C1 level or even improved to C2. But if you haven't been doing the other skills, they have most likely gone down to a B2 or maybe even lower level if your C1 level was not attained a long time before you actually earned that in your proficiency exam. So it's important to know what your current level is. And as you set these goals at the beginning of 2021, make sure that you understand that. I will be doing a Cambridge proficiency test level video where you can do it together with me here on my channel within the next month or two. So make sure that you hit subscribe with the notifications on, and also that you can join my Facebook group. I will note that there. I have links to it in my Facebook group, so you can actually take the exam in the meantime online completely free. Now, if you don't know what to do once you know your level and you're still struggling to create these SMART goals, you can contact me or another qualified teacher to help set those goals. You don't even necessarily need to sign up for lessons or classes with an English teacher. You can always just sign up for 1 or 2 hours with the English teacher and create a self-study plan and to set some goals that are really strong and solid. And you will get some good advice if it is a qualified good teacher that you go to. Tip number 4 is to set a realistic study schedule in order to achieve these SMART goals. And once you make this schedule, stick to it. Okay, so the worst thing about a beautifully crafted schedule or plan is the lack of follow through, not sticking to it, not getting it done, right? So thoughts or dreams are great, but they aren't action. You need to actually do the things that you plan on doing in order to see any improvement. So I always advise to try to cut out small chunks of your day to really dedicate solely to English. If you know that you have the whole day on Saturday free and that you don't have anything to do, take a look at what the rest of your week looks like. How many hours are you working? How many hours are you studying? How many hours do you dedicate to spending time with family or friends or your boyfriend or girlfriend or wife or husband, your kids, your whoever? How much time do you spend with your pets? How much time do you spend on your hobbies? And see where do you actually have these holes of time. And if you don't have any holes of time during the week, but you do for the entire weekend or one entire weekend day, Think about whether it's actually realistic to spend an entire day studying English. It's probably not. You probably have cleaning to do or want to rest or do something else, see a friend occasionally. So I always recommend to try to do your learning in chunks and to not try to learn, try not to learn more than about 1.5 to 2 hours at a time. You can do 1.5 or 2 hours Saturday morning, use the rest of the day up until the evening to do whatever else you want. And then again at nighttime, before you go to bed, study another hour or two, and then you get a really good chunk of time that is split between the morning and night. You could do that. Now, let's address another issue. But Ashley, you may say, I don't have any time. That's not true. You don't have any time? Okay, set your schedule, make it really specific, everything you need to do. Now take that time that you wake up to do what you need to do, and start 1/2 hour earlier, okay? So 30 minutes earlier every weekday. Set your alarm. You're getting up 30 minutes earlier. You're going to do at least 15 minutes of English learning in that time. That way you have a little bit of buffer time. You can set snooze once, press snooze once, maybe take a little bit longer while making your coffee because you're tired, you woke up 1/2 hour earlier. Take that time, 15 minutes. That's all I ask. Okay, or 15 minutes during your lunch break. Find 15 minutes to make sure every single day during the week that you are practicing something that helps you attain at least one of your SMART goals for the year for your English learning. I always advise doing it first thing in the morning so it's done, you won't forget about it, you won't push it off to the next day. It's great to wake up just a little bit earlier, not a crazy amount, but just a little bit, and do something fun, whether it's watch a TED talk in the morning first thing, or you know, comment and watch one of your favorite YouTube videos, or it is to write a message back and forth, maybe you found a language buddy online, whatever it is, whatever skill it is that you're trying to improve, try to do that first thing in the morning, just 15 minutes a day if you can't find enough time elsewhere in the week. And even if you do have a lot of study time elsewhere in the week, getting it done first thing in the morning is still ideal because you know you won't push it off. So it's great to just wake up and put your mind in an English linguistic mindset. Okay, tip number 5, set a monetary budget. So how much money you are able or willing to spend on learning English this year. So maybe you don't have any money. That's fine, your budget's zero. You can still learn a ton without spending any money. But there are often things and services and teachers and classes and apps and different things that you can purchase or download, books that you can buy, subscriptions you can subscribe to, memberships, etc. So many different things that can help your specific SMART goals to make it easier and simply to learn at a deeper level. There are so many things out there that you can do. You don't have to spend thousands and thousands of dollars or euros or yen or whatever currency you have. You don't have to spend a ton of money in order to learn. But there are certain things that help make learning easier. There are certain apps or certain books or memberships to a really nice online academy or online courses, or of course the creme de la creme, the best way to learn for specific goals is private lessons. Yes, those are things that are expensive, but you can also find less expensive versions of these things. Let's say perhaps you need to improve your vocabulary. That's something that you can really do affordably on your own. There are apps that are free, there are apps that are low cost, there are tons of different studying methods that you can do, so much material available online or in a book. You may even want to, if you're having trouble finding these free resources, you may even want to pay a qualified English teacher for a 1-hour private lesson in order to set up a way that you could learn for free on your own after that 1-hour lesson. There are teachers such as myself that specialize in that and really set a plan for you to learn on your own. And there are many different Facebook groups, such as my own, as well as others that help build a community where you can learn with others and do peer learning as well. So set your budget to fit your SMART goals. Focus, get laser focused on the things that you need to improve. Saying you want to improve your English basically doesn't help because there's so much more to that. You need to get specific. What parts of English, which skill, listening, reading, writing, speaking, which skill is it that you want to improve and how do you want to improve it? And how are you measuring that? Is this based on levels? Is this based on how many words you know? Is this based on how understandable you are? Whether you're able to use specific purpose English, so business English or English for nurses or whatever it is, for telemarketing, try to find your goal and be specific about it and set your budget around your goals. Okay, tip number six, or six if you're American like me, but I'm American and European, so it doesn't count. Okay, tip number six. This is to learn idioms and vocabulary in context. Okay, so don't simply learn individual words. That's good, but if you just do that all the time, getting to a fluent level is going to take forever and be very difficult. So you should learn idioms. What are idioms, you ask? Idioms are kind of groups of words or pairs of words that individually mean something different than when they're used together. For example, if we say, oh, he got cold feet before his wedding, we're not saying that the man's feet were cold. He wasn't shivering. Cold feet means that you get nervous or scared about something. You start to doubt it, right? So if you didn't know that idiom, you may be kind of confused. You know what the word cold means. You know what the word feet means, but used together, you don't understand what that means. So learning idioms is really important, as well as learning vocabulary in context. I will put links to different books that are useful in the description box. They are affiliate links, so if you click them, I will get a small commission, or anything else you buy after you click that link on Amazon, I would get a small commission. So I would really appreciate if you would consider using that if you're buying something from Amazon. But then also there are some different channels. I have some videos on idioms and I plan on continuing that and posting more videos. And another two channels that you can look at for idioms and vocabulary learning, I will put in the description box, Rachel's English and Colin Maltman English. Those are two of my favorites, very different channels, both very good for those two things. I have one more good tip for you about learning vocabulary in context. So besides reading books where obviously the word or articles where the words are given to you in a specific context, you can also try watching television, put on whatever your favorite English series is and put on the subtitles. And whenever a word comes up that you don't know, pause it and look that word up in the actual dictionary. So online or a hard copy, and write down what that, have your vocabulary notebook with you as you're watching. Write down the word, write down the dictionary definition, write down synonyms, so words that mean the same thing, other words, as well as antonyms, words that are the opposites, as well as other uses of the words and the example sentences that they give there. And then try to write your own example sentence. Yes, this will interrupt your show. Yes, this will take some time. You will need to spend a good 5 to 10 minutes per word probably while doing this. But you will learn this so much better. You will remember that word. You will remember the scene on the television show, what you were watching at that time. And then you'll remember writing it down and what you were looking up on the computer. It's active learning. So passively watching English television, it's better than nothing, but it's not that great for actually becoming a proficient speaker yourself in that target language. But if you make it an active activity, watching it, putting the subtitles on, pausing when you don't know words, looking up the word and writing down, taking all the notes and using it yourself in a sentence as well, that will really make those words stick and you will learn a lot more that way. Tip number seven is to use it or lose it. So even if you are, let's say, every single day, 7 days a week, spending half an hour or an hour studying English, if you're just doing grammar exercises in a book and reading books and watching TV, you're not really actively using it yourself. As I was saying in the last tip with writing your own sentence, that's actively using the language yourself. So I highly recommend when you're watching YouTube videos, scroll down to the comment sections, leave a comment, read the other comments, reply to the comments, start a conversation. When you join these English language groups, don't simply passively read what's going on. interject yourself, join the conversation, post your own questions, start discussions, and have that back and forth. That's extremely important. You want to make sure that you start these conversations and that you practice speaking and writing yourself. Be sure not to just practice the writing aspect of using language yourself, but also the speaking. So you can practice by speaking yourself at home, whether it is you're in the shower in the morning and you want to talk about what you're going to, you're thinking about what you want to do for the day. You can talk out loud in English and do it in English out loud. That still counts as practice, right? Or if you're driving to work, you can explain to yourself out loud the things you're going to do first and respond to this email. And then we're going to have a meeting. The meeting will be about X, Y, and Z. Practice speaking by yourself. Find a language buddy or somebody online that you can have some WhatsApp calls with or FaceTime. Practice speaking with them. Join a conversation class or hire a tutor or a private teacher to have some lessons where you can speak. And just try to speak as much as you can and practice, practice, practice. Don't just immerse yourself in the language, interject yourself into the language. Make sure you are consuming and using as much English as much as possible. So it becomes part of your life rather than a thing you do for a few hours each week. Tip number 8, I always use the American one instead of the European one. Tip number 8 is to mimic either native or proficient English speakers. To mimic means basically to copy and to try to reproduce the same sounds. So when you're watching YouTube videos such as my own or somebody else's or TV or movies, try to listen carefully to how they're pronouncing certain words. Where is the stress? Where is the intonation? And what is the rise and fall of the sentences? How do they ask questions? How do they do their different stress points? How do they pronounce words? And try to copy them. If you're struggling and simply trying to copy them or mimic them isn't really working out, I highly advise that you go over to that channel, Rachel's English, and watch some of her pronunciation videos. She is highly specialized in how to use your mouth to make American English sounds. There are, of course, great channels for British English sounds as well. Those I am less informed on. So if you want some recommendations, leave a comment and I will look into some British English. But for American English, I highly recommend you check out Rachel's English. Tip number 9 is to read. Reading is so underrated when it comes to learning a language. Every single day, I learn new words in all three of my languages, English, German, and Dutch. My own language as well. And that's because you read things from other writers who have different experiences and backgrounds and cultures, and there are so many words in English. There's just so much possibility for you to learn, whether it's your own native language or a target language that you're trying to learn. Reading is really helpful. It's not just about learning new words, but you also really understand grammar in a contextual setting. You understand the cultural aspects as well, from where that author comes from, and sentence structure and flow. It's so important to read English articles and read English books as much as you can. Okay, my last and final tip for the day, tip number 10, that is to get feedback. So I've given you many tips today for what you can do by yourself, how you can learn for free by yourself at home, what you can do on your own with these SMART goals that you create for yourself. But at some point in time, you're going to need some feedback, because speaking a language or knowing a language, it is a form of communication, and you do need some feedback, whether it is from another student, a peer of yours, or if it's from a professional. Feedback is crucial to improving and even maintaining your English skills. So I definitely recommend joining a conversation class or having even just be a part of a Facebook group where you guys do some, have a chat group and you can get some feedback or you can ask some questions. It's extremely important to get feedback on your work. If you are looking for an English teacher or to join a supportive community, I have many different options at International Yankee English that go beyond just private lessons. We also have a Facebook group, support group. We have monthly conversation classes. We have a business English course coming up in February. If you'd like some more information about that, just contact me. So make sure that you get feedback in some kind of form so that you can continue improving, because you may be making several mistakes that you don't realize you're making. And once you make those mistakes into errors and they become habits, it's much harder to break it then down the road. So that's it for today. I hope you guys found this useful and helpful. Please comment below which tip you plan on using. If you want even more tips, you can go back. I'll link in the description box and put up here in the cards a video I did about language learning, my top 5 tips how to learn a language. I go into a little bit more detail on some of those tips. There is some overlap with this video, but I recommend going after this. If you haven't watched that video already, go ahead to that video and get some more information about how you can set your 2021 English SMART goals. And again, make sure to hit the like and subscribe buttons, and I will see you guys next week for another Motivational Monday English learning video. Bye.